Okay, we will call the meeting to order. All board members accounted for, all admins are here as well. One change in the agenda is a scheduled presenter, Deputy Chief Wisniewski, will not be here this evening for the liaison conversation, so we can strike that scheduled presenter. And under old business, also strike the consideration to approve the liaison. There's been some conversation, I think, with the city that maybe we don't have an exact dollar amount as of yet. So there's just no point in even having a presentation done if we don't know if the outcome is going to result in any further conversation, I guess. So we'll await the city council's discussion and deal with it as it comes up. Does anyone else have any additions to the agenda, deletions, changes of any kind? If not, I would look for a motion to approve.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second.
Motion by Pat, seconded by Kurt. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Approval of the minutes for March 25, April 8. Has everyone had a chance to look those over, and there's any concerns or additions?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
Brenda.
I'll second.
Seconded by Rob. Further discussion?
I'm just looking at number 12 in the minutes. It just talked about 600 to 800,000 is the ballpark ending balance for fiscal year 13, which is about half the recommended amount. And Mike can run this by you, Josh. Is that the recommended amount, or is that just something that we'd like to have? Did the auditors say we recommend this, or was it?
They do it.
Okay.
Yeah. You could say it's recommended by the auditors.
Yeah. Okay.
Anyone else? All approved, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Finance report. Josh?
It starts on page 6 of your packet. There's Captain B. And just kind of go through the quick version of this. There's not a whole lot of change from last month or really from month to month. We kind of go through the same process. But first page is your cash flow worksheet. Again, checking accounts at two banks that are doing a switch over, Merchants Bank and then First Farm and Merchants. Cash through the rest of the fiscal year will show as a positive balance. And again, as we talked about, there's no anticipation borrowing. That's all cash on our own. As the state has changed the formula this year based on their budget projections. Next page would be the summary of the last month reconciled. March 2013 versus 2012. And then the following page would be the detail. And again, real similar to what we've gone through the last few months. So you've had the information. And really not anything to highlight or point out necessarily, so if you have any questions, I can certainly do my best to help to answer anything you have. Otherwise, it's pretty standard to what we had from the previous year. The big note, again, would be the shift in money from the state last year, 60-40 for ideas. So you'll see less revenue last year versus this year, where we're getting almost a 90%. It means smaller aid payments in August and September, but at least we're not having to borrow cash right now. We're quoting our own cash. If you have any questions on the finance report, like I said, pretty standard from what we've had in the last few months, but I can certainly answer whatever you have.
I'll make a motion to approve the finance report.
I'll second.
Motion by Pat, seconded by Jerry. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Under old business, consideration to reduce 1.0 elementary PE position effective this upcoming year. This is part of the third round of cuts that we had discussed, and we had it on the docket for last time, but it was important to have the whole board here for discussion. You know, a little history on this is always when we get to this time of the year, we're asking our admin to bring forth reductions or changes in their personal budgets to fit the direction that we need to go as a school district. and they diligently follow direction and come up with a number of ideas for us, and most of them are excellent. As a matter of fact, they're all excellent. But at the same time, we're, sometimes we get caught in that situation is, when is that cut our last cut, or when can we proceed on without having to make substantial cuts, and especially in personnel? You folks that have been around on the board long enough understand that these are tough times for us, but at the same time, I believe that there's a possibility that in conversation that, or in articles that you read, maybe the legislature is finally understanding that 5 or 6 years of no increase in school needs to end. Having said that, we still have to work through this because we still have to look at this as a potential time that we will continue to cut. So I guess having said that and just laying the groundwork out, Derek has done a very good job here in his reductions, and it was his recommendation that we can make a 1.0 reduction in PE work. Derek and I have had conversations about it, and again, I'm just opening this up for discussion with the board. But as comfortable as I am with that recommendation, I'm more comfortable with the retention of that PE. And some would say it's because that it's the person, but my friend Rob has reminded me over and over again that I was the one who said many years ago, it's not really a personal cut, it's a professional cut that we need to make on behalf of our district. So, you know, having said that, I believe it's in our best interest to continue with the PE as is right now. Jerry and I had a chance to visit with Sue Bramer and Ross Peterson from the elementary school. We've talked to Derek as well. And I think, you know, there's a lot to be said for both, but leading into that conversation, I would like some other input here.
I think just as an update or a reminder too, we've already cut a 1.0 PE in addition at an earlier meeting, so that would actually be our second in one area.
I'm torn on it from two sides, and I think I talked to Derek about it a couple times, and Tim, I like the plan that these guys have in their buildings. I like to listen to the plans that they're going to change into what they want it to be a better education system for Cannon Falls. But then the other side of me says that we've asked Beth for 2 years not to reduce any or make any personnel cuts if possible. And this is the last cut of the second year, and we've been successful. If we don't cut this, we'll have 2 years of no teacher cuts. We'll have retirements and attrition that we haven't replaced, but we haven't cut. And I know I was one of the board members who, when Beth came on, I said, Beth, whatever you do, don't do that. So I'm torn.
I guess my bigger concern is if this cut's made, then we lose all DAP teachers. So would it be looking at bringing back somebody part-time? And I guess if we're making that cut and we'd have to hire back in part-time, to me it doesn't make any sense. And part, as well as having one FIA teacher in elementary school trying to grade 400 kids or 500 kids, whatever number falls in there. Not that they're incapable of doing it, but I just have an issue when kids go to FIA and they have 25 minutes and you have one teacher that's 50 kids in a room and you got 30 seconds to spend per child with that activity. To me, isn't enough. I think kids sit, when they're not in school, they sit in front of their computers or on their cell phones, they get no activity as it is. We start cutting any activity they have going on during the day, I guess it's, to me, I have a problem with it. As well as if that would end up happening, if that would happen, I would much rather see it be in second graders and third graders or third graders, and not second graders or third graders or whatever. But I guess my bigger issue is the amount of time being spent with each individual child per class, and losing a DAEP instructor. I don't know what the impact is going to be there, but if we're losing a DAEP and means us hiring somebody else in, I'm personally not in favor of it.
Does he
I'm not sure we lose a DAEP instructor, but at the same time, we may be engaging all of our PE people and not have enough space for that DAEP as well.
We'd still have one person that is capable of instructing DAEP, correct?
We only have one DAEP teacher right now, and she is still, Mr. Roos, well, the position that's listed tonight is not a DAEP teacher.
Right.
Right.
But the elimination of the current PE to the high school DAEP, if I'm understanding.
You mean the first reduction?
The first reduction.
Yes, you're correct on that.
And Sue is the only other DAEP instructor, which is the elementary.
I see what you mean. That makes sense.
So if we eliminate that position, she'd have no time to instruct DAEP. So that'd mean bringing in, hiring somebody else in to teach DAEP.
There may not be a huge need for additional DAEP, but it will cost us money.
Kurt? Just in general, is the DAEP, it's going to cost us either way, correct? If we keep this position or get rid of the position, we still have to provide another, possibly some more revenue or expenditure for another.
It's how you look at it, you know, per the contract, we would be able to rearrange the current, if we only have one person that's licensed to teach adaptive, physical, or any of the DAEP type things, we can rearrange their schedule. It's not ideal because then you're taking an elementary PE teacher and having them walk to the high school, and perhaps even taking a high school teacher and having them walk to the elementary. It's kind of a silly use of time, but certainly with schedules, you could make that happen. We have to have one person that's licensed to teach that. Keep in mind, we don't know what our DAEP numbers are for next year. You can have a family move in and have three kids that qualify for adaptive. So it's kind of a, you know, we wouldn't even start looking at that. I don't think the principals, we'd look at it probably even until July when we start looking at scheduling. So it's a tough one.
I think there's a couple of things to be said, in my opinion, and that is you pretty much expressed my feelings too, both Rob and Jared. There's one thing that's to be said, and that is, does it make scheduling easier in the elimination of the cut? That's a possibility. However, there is a point where it's nice to keep the people that we have at this point. We haven't had to go to that point, and whether or not we want to, you know, we've got a general fund out there, and it's a healthy fund, in my opinion. And in that respect, I think we have that opportunity to look at it differently. I applaud you, Derek, and going out on the limb here and saying this is one of the areas that we could look at. None of them are popular. But at this point, I think it's a better thing to keep what we have and seeing where we're at next year.
Pat, you asked not to be called on.
And thanks for honoring that. I said from the beginning, it's a numbers thing. You can't have, you know, we got 500 kids down there, we got two FIED teachers. You can't have one FIED teacher taking care of 500 students. That's bottom line. So I'm against the cut.
Brenda.
Well, I agree with Kurt because I'm on the curriculum committee, and I'm impressed with it, what Derek has done to work out the scheduling, with cutting down to one elementary PE, but I think we've already cut the program, and that would just probably not work out that well, or that would hurt the PE program, even though it might work well for the overall scheduling. And if there's any way we can afford to keep that, and if our general fund can support it, then I would be in favor of keeping it.
Okay. Anybody else have anything to add? So, we need a motion either way on this.
I'll make a motion that we look at this and we keep the PE position currently in place.
I'll second that.
Kurt makes a motion to not reduce the 1.0 and continue as is, and that was seconded by Rob, correct?
Yep.
Okay. Anyone else? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Under new biz, approval of the lunch report, attachment C. Folks, you had a chance to look at that? Actually, this is all under the personnel and attendance is all under the consent agenda. My bad. So take a look at all three of those, and under the consent agenda, we as a rule will consider these all routine, and we'll enact them in one motion, unless for some reason somebody wants them out.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Motion by Jerry. Hear a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Rob. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Item B, approval of expenditures, attachment F. Have you had a chance to look these over? Do you have any questions on them?
Do we pay toner and on the lease? I thought that was included.
Yes, Rob. We have to buy toner on top of the lease. We're almost done.
Boy, let's hope we get done with that lease soon.
As long as you got copies, you're gonna be done.
Huh?
I mean, you're always gonna have to have toner.
Is this the last one, though?
No.
Oh, the last one was here.
That $392.64 Fitzgerald Excavating, $3,300, that's...
Water main break.
Yeah. And we can't hope that that's the only bill we're gonna get either. Have we paid any bills to date on that? I was expecting we were gonna have $20,000.
A little over $5,000.
$39,268, Goodie County Ed District. Program charges?
Yes, that's normal. We contract out a lot of special services that we receive, so every month we have program charges to pay back to them.
$39,311, and I guess this is just a comment, $19,000 for substitute staffing. I've not seen that before, that much. Is it unusual? Huh?
Well, we just started the service this year.
Okay.
It has been averaging between $8,000 and $10,000 up to $19,000. That's about 1 month.
We were paying it in payroll before, now we pay the service. But it's still in line to be cheaper than it was before, so hopefully it stays that way.
Good. At least it breaks it off, so we kinda see that part of it.
Right, you do know the monthly charge, though. Otherwise, you would never see that.
I like that.
Okay, anything else?
I'll make a motion to approve the expenditures.
I'll second.
Motion by Pat, seconded by Jerry. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Brenda, get ready for your resolution stuff, but resolution to non-renew Kevin Landry's contract due to reductions in student enrollment and financial limitations. More procedural, you made this cut already, but a non-tenured staff, we need to go through our usual procedural items, correct?
Correct.
So what we do need, since we've already cut that position, is to officially non-renew, and I would need a motion and a second, and then Brenda can do her resolution.
I'll make the motion.
Then I'll second.
Kurt, seconded by Pat. Other discussion? I think we can get by with the bowl stuff on top.
Resolution relating to the termination and non-renewal of the teaching contract of Kevin Landy, probationary teacher. Rob?
Yes.
Brenda, yes. Jerry?
Yes.
Bob?
Yes.
Pat?
Yes.
Kurt?
Yes.
Okay, that passes by a 6-0 vote. Item D, consideration to approve the activities handbook. Who wants to take the lead on this?
Turn it over to Jake.
Jake?
Just updated a few things, cleaned up some grammatical things, but no major changes. The biggest thing you see is the academic policy for middle school, which we just eliminated. We did that earlier this fall. You guys voted to approve that, so nothing major that you haven't seen already.
Okay, any questions?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Seconded by Pat, seconded by Rob. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye. Aye. Opposed? That is carried. Item E, discussion soccer. So unless a lot of people were here to talk about Dave Davison, then I guess they're here to talk soccer and football and its relativity. You know, quite honestly, I wasn't aware of the length of time that soccer's been in existence because my kids all melted into the woodwork a number of years ago and moved on. So I know that it's been out there for quite a while, but this is actually, I think, whenever we received our preliminary agenda, the first shot that many of us have seen here. And many questions, but just for your information out there, a school board discussion means that the discussion is among board members. We can ask for input and may with folks like Jake or facilities, maybe with Dave, but by and large, it's an opportunity for the board to engage in an open forum, and sadly without the input, but that's the way the procedure is. At the end of the meeting, there is time for public forum. And certainly anybody that wishes to speak to that, depending on the number of people that we have, we limit the amount of time. But what I would request from people who speak in any direction on this is that maybe you can get together and have a common viewpoint and maybe have people speak on your behalf so we don't have 25 people essentially saying the same thing. So if it does get to be that at the end of the, during the public forum, I'll probably end up discontinuing it because it's the right of the board, I guess. So hopefully you can express your viewpoints in some type of spokesperson forum that would fit us all best.
And Bob, just for point of inquiry, is this really an action item or is this discussion?
This is just a discussion item. So, you know, not very long ago, we had a meeting of John Birch Park Committee, and I'll pull that into soccer. But it had a lot to do with the use of John Birch Park and the amount of usage it's gotten since we moved our games, if you will, and even some practices down to John Birch Park because of our renovation we've done. As we renovated back there, we lost space for practice time and maybe even for game time, but certainly practice time. And adding a sports program is not really a small step, regardless of how long it's been in existence, because there's a lot of things you check into, and among them, in my book, is the facilities. John Birch Park is taken a real beating, and it's nobody's fault. It's just the dynamic of putting a lot of activity down there temporarily. My opinion is it needs to get moved back up here, just because we have the facility to at least support some, you know, our football games here, I would hope. You know, having said that, we get into situations where if there's a practice going on and we're asking to move our sports programs up here, when can you have a game and a practice at the same time with the limited space that we have? So that's kind of my segue into this, is that at least one of the topics we need to speak on is our facilities. And I know that we've got this big green space in front, and Dave and I have had conversations for years about it. And it's a beautiful area back there, but when is the time that we use it for our student activities, whether they be football or soccer, or we use it for youth sports all the time, but it does need to be graded and reseeded or sodded or whatever the situation to be, to provide more space. That's among my biggest concerns about all of this, and you may all come from different directions, but Title IX would be an issue as well. The funding for the program as well, and I guess I've heard some rumor about where that would go. But since this is board discussion at this point in time, I think that we, you know, we just pose our concerns, and between now and maybe the next meeting, the subsequent meeting, we can get into more serious discussion or make it an action item. But I'm open. What do you think? Rob?
You know, I feel that adding a sport, there is a lot of work to it. I think my approach might be a little bit different. My thoughts are a little bit different maybe than most people. When I sit up here and we make the decisions, I think of the 1,200 kids that we've got in our school district and what we're doing for them. How do we impact them the best? How do we do what's best for them? And I do get the grass situation. I do get the fields. But I guess I look at it and say, I would hate to restrict an activity because the grass isn't up to par. I would hate for us to restrict our kids getting good physical activity, which we just talked about with the PE teacher, because our grass doesn't look as good as maybe another school. And I do get you do need to maintain a certain quality, but I think it's more important on the kids who are on the grass than the grass itself. I think the biggest part here is the support from the administration and the AD. Can we do this? Is this something that we're prepared? Should we have done a long time ago? Should we do it now? Should we do it in a couple of years? And that's really my big question. The grass is going to be the grass, and unless we buy more real estate or we get creative, it's going to be the way it is. And I think at points we've got to get creative.
Well, you know, I agree with you, and I'm not downplaying the soccer thing at all. I think that more opportunity is a good thing. But my statement about John Birch Park lends itself more to where are we going to find the space if we move everybody up here?
Well, and I like your idea about the front of the school. And is that, I mean, for whatever practice it may be, I don't know if we can hold a couple of practices in the front of the school. I know, again, I think that's a touchy subject because it is the front of the school. But we do have we got some of the biggest piece of real estate around.
And everyone does realize that soccer, he's got a St. Paul's and beautiful soccer fields up there,
right,
that are very willing to support us. If you talk to the other HVL schools, they don't have something as amazing as St. Paul's willing to, you know, use their facilities as well. And that's a great relationship between the soccer parents and St. Paul's. It also creates a great relationship with our, you know, non-public school as well. So
right. And I hear that we're having issues already. I think if anything, maybe a subcommittee or a committee put together of the fields and everything and revamp. I know there's discussion about bringing varsity up here. There's discussion about not bringing varsity up here. What games should be played where? You know, I think in the last 10 years, there's a lot changed at this school. We've lost some playing field, but we've also gained a beautiful bleacher area back here. Should we sit down and really look at that as well? And at the same point, you know, if soccer is going to be something that it's not going to be here for 2 years, do we have 2 years to look at that if it does come and figure out how do we handle it?
I don't even know so much it's a two-year soccer field. I think that St. Paul's would be open to discuss how long we could utilize those fields. But
more than two, maybe?
More than two, probably.
Okay.
And that piece really doesn't concern me that much on the onset of having a soccer program come is the field space. If St. Paul's is willing to let us utilize that space behind their facility, I think it will be very little impact on our usage of the property around here and who's playing on what fields. I will touch on John Birch, and I absolutely agree with Bob. You know, I went to school here. I graduated from here, and for a lot of years, the junior high and elementary was always held off back, especially with football. But to get to John Birch Park, and maybe a little old school here, but that was kind of a privilege as you went through the program to play down there on a Friday night. Now everybody's going down there. I would like to see the elementary and the junior high maybe move more of their stuff up here to preserve the John Birch Park. Granted, it all goes through the city, but the school is the one that gets the flak from the city when the field's not up to speed. And I don't know that it's, we should be taking a flack when they have outside activities that aren't necessarily sponsored by the school. But if we have an opportunity to bring those kids back up here and keep them off that field, I think that's a, that helps the city and it helps the school and it helps that field. And if they're gonna let us, if soccer does come and they let us retain those fields behind their complex, to me that's a pretty valid, void argument for me, but.
I'll bring us back one more time. The discussion shouldn't be specifically John Birch Park, but it's the available of usable facilities for us. And again, it's one thing to have soccer games, and I would think that we would have them at least three levels, because you're gonna have a varsity and probably a JV and probably a junior high. And those kids all need to practice on a daily basis. And would St. Paul's say okay to 5 days a week usage? And
They're saying yes.
So, you know, the John Birch Park dynamic is more to take more stress out of it. And again, we've had conversations with several people there, and I think everybody is in agreement. It looks pretty rough. And I don't think it's any fault. The city employees have just been stellar in being there for us whenever we ask, but there was just no time for that place to breathe. And among the activities that was down there was a couple of soccer games. So I know that St. Paul is the facility, but at the same time, you know, if you ask soccer, would you like to play down there on a Thursday night with the lights on? Wow, another privilege. But at the same time, at what expense? And again, where do we find that extra space? We're gonna tell people we're gonna move our junior high and maybe even higher athletics up here, but where's the space? You know, you add soccer into that dynamic somewhere, and I just think it's gonna affect us. And again, I like more opportunity, but I don't think we've had the opportunity in 5 days to discuss all there is to it.
I just think, yeah, we probably just need further study on it. I like the idea. I really do. I think kids have to have an opportunity to play something that maybe football is too much of a contact sport for some kids, and they don't like that, and they'd like another opportunity out there. Basically, cross country and football is all they have. There's kids that just want to play, and I think sometimes we don't allow that. And it's to no one's fault by any means. It's just we have football and we have cross country. But I think we need to look at what our options are. If St. Paul says that they're okay with it and it's something they can manage, now I don't know when they can do their soccer, because they have the youth soccer there too, I believe. And if that can work, and how do you work, you know, games that they have to be, you know, as it gets old, later in the fall, the evenings come dark, gets darker, and they have no lights up there, am I correct? I don't know if that, but I mean, things like that have to be worked out, and we'd have to look at all the options there. And, you know, there's Title IX, where is the quality of field equitable to both sides, to both the girls and boys, and we have to look at all that too, but I like the idea.
See, what's interesting about that, and Jake's probably feeling the same way, the first year I was on as superintendent, this group, they hit me right away. Like, ooh, we got new blood, we're gonna come in and talk soccer, and I wasn't ready for that, I wasn't prepared for that. We didn't financially have, you know, anything to stand on. They worked really hard at getting to that point. I feel like we have been discussing soccer for 2 years now. I feel like we have been working on data and putting that together, and it has been kind of drawn out. I feel like we do have all of that together. What happens for me is I take families on tours, and I'm always kind of surprised when they say, you don't have soccer? How can you be in the HVL and not have soccer? Well, we have cheerleading, and we have cross country, and they're very small teams, but we don't have soccer, which impacts a lot of kids. That's been difficult, and surprisingly, because I'm a non-soccer, I don't know much about soccer either, was really surprised to see so many families wondering, you know, why we don't have soccer. You know, they're transporting their kids over to Northfield and paying a much larger amount to go play over there. You know, how many kids would we get to come here? And since I've started here, we've increased enrollment every year, and you've told me to look at revenue, and you've told me to try and find ways to increase that. Soccer is a method to do that. for the first couple of years. You know, we've got 2 years where we can commit to lower amounts. So I can appreciate what you're saying, Kurt, because I feel like it is probably new to you. But if you need that data, we have all that. We've been working on it for 2 years, and I, you know, if Jake has anything to say on it too, this isn't new to us.
Okay.
We've been meeting, it feels like a little bit too much on soccer.
There's another way of looking at it too, and that is, if we don't do anything, if we don't do it now, nothing that I can foresee in the future is going to change with what we have for fields and what we're going to do and how we're going to have to manage it either anyways, sometime or another to make it happen if that's what we want to do. So do we do it now, or, you know, when's that time ever going to come?
Well, and that's why, you know, you have this 2 year trial period per se, you know, and I guess that's one way to look at it. A terrible thing to end something in 2 years, but then, you know, is that a trial period? Or most schools don't have the facilities like we would have up at St. Paul's. Jake, do any other schools have that? I mean, we're kind of a unique situation. I don't know if you've been back behind St. Paul's, but they've just got some beautiful fields and practice fields, and I do think our boys and girls could both be there in Title IX. We are completely covered in all of that. Jake's done a tremendous amount of research on that because we want to make sure we're in compliance with everything. But, you know, my fear would be the other sports. You know, you don't want to, we're at that perfect amount of 1,200 kids. You don't want us to pull from the football program, and you don't want to pull from your tennis program. You want to make sure you keep that balance. But surprisingly enough, and you can see the kids in this room, they're soccer kids. You're not going to make them become something else overnight. They are soccer kids. I mean, I'm looking at the boys in the back there. That's what they are, and that's what they dress in every day. they're soccer kids. So, you know, I don't know. Tough choice for you guys. I don't know.
Well, me and Beth and Jake met the soccer group 2 weeks ago. Do you want to speak at all on that?
You know, just what kind of what we agreed on, what we decided that we'd bring to you guys, what the agreement right now, if it goes through, would be that games and practices would be at St. Paul or the elementary school, where we're currently are practicing. School would collect registration fees, just like we currently do. But with that, we would only pay transportation and officials. So the soccer group would be in charge of all other startup costs, game workers, things like that, the coach. They compete at three levels, both boys and girls. So a varsity, a JV, and then most HBL schools have a junior high team, so one team. They'd be a 2 year agreement. So that's kind of what came out of that meeting.
And again, the 2 years that we've been talking about, the 2 year agreement would be funded for 2 years away from the district?
Yeah. Right. Other than transportation and
materials. But they're paying an administrative fee to play the sports as well, so we can take some of that towards and offset those costs a little bit.
Oh, more than offset it, because they'd only have, like, for next year, only three home games.
Okay, so that would actually increase a little bit of, not much, but a small revenue increase in that area.
I like to say it balances things out.
Okay.
It's cost neutral.
Okay. So, from your standpoint, what would we need to do? I mean, from a district, we've got the facilities, it sounds like, for 2 years. The money's been taken care of. What would the school need to do?
Well, the big question is, what do you do after 2 years? I think that's what you got to look at.
Well,
does St. Paul let us play on their fields for the next 50 years? Or do they decide that they don't want to do that anymore? Then how do we fund six coaches and pay for all the other costs associated with it?
You know, and I guess my thoughts on that is, we get kind of 2 free years to see what this program can really be. Does it take off or does it not? And I think by year two, we may know our own answer one way or the other. But to get 2 years free, I don't know any other sport that we're doing that with, that we get really a trial basis to find out what is the school district capable of supporting with a sport not really costing the district money. And even if it does take off, we've got 2 years to put into a plan. How do we rearrange our fields? It sounds like we probably should start looking at that regardless, because of the condition of the field at St. John Birch. Do we do that starting this year? And we don't even have to worry about soccer. But looking at if that's added, what are we going to do with it? I mean, like Kurt said, unless we buy real estate, our fields are our fields. And if that's our excuse today, our excuse in 2 years or 5 years or 10 years, we don't have the real estate to do it on.
Brenda?
I had a question, because I haven't heard any of this information until now, so. How is the soccer group is paying for the coaching for the first 2 years, or?
Or volunteers, yeah.
It's volunteer coaching?
Or, yeah, or they pay it, but it would be no cost. But we would do the hiring, we'd do anything.
Jake would still be the, you know, the boss of the coach, they'd have to still follow. He would still be in charge of them.
Yeah, the athletic.
Yeah, they have the fields, the nets, the cones, the.
Big question I had is how can we make sure this is a sustainable program, not when these kids graduate, the program's just gonna go away. There's a big soccer league at St. Paul's, and they're confident as well that those kids will keep coming, so.
How many kids do they estimate playing this summer?
I think so, yeah.
312. 312, wasn't it, Adam? 312.
Pretty good number.
And we're okay type of line right now, as long as the numbers that come out are still proportional. I mean, if we get more boys than girls that come out, then we might be thrown out of line.
Well, we've got tennis too to come.
Are we looking at letting Randolph in a part of that, or?
We could look at a co-op, we haven't discussed that or anything.
Who co-ops in our conference?
Just Pine Island and the Broncos that are together. Otherwise, everybody else has their own team except for Hayfield, Triton, Kenyon, and Goodwin.
All fairly substantially smaller than we are.
Much smaller.
My involvement into this started about a year and a half ago. I got a call from a soccer mom that, hi.
Well, she called you too, did she?
Uh-huh. You know, she said, you know, the kids are playing, they're working hard, they'd really like to be part of the HVL, like all the other kids are playing in HVL sports. It's really what they want. Instead of going chasing after games and towns against kids they don't know, they really want to take on Pine Island and Zumbrota and Kenyon, and they want to be HVL athletes. And I said, sounds good to me, call Jake. This is a no-brainer. I don't know, you got kids that are out there playing, they're already organized, they're not in any other sports. Up until about a few days ago, when I got the list of things from the coaches that got together, I really hadn't thought about a whole lot of this stuff, because it's kind of been out of sight, out of mind. It really has. I think the coaches do raise some valid points. And real quick, I got just a couple written down here, you know. You know, it's easy to say, well, we're gonna fund it all. But really, bottom line, I don't know if everything can be funded. And if it's gonna be funded for 2 years, that's great, but then somebody over those 2 years has to keep track of what the actual cost is going to be once it's no longer being funded, so that the district understands 2 years from now what it's going to absorb as a cost, okay? So if it's 30 grand, or I'm just throwing that out, it's 30 grand, then, you know, we have to know that 2 years from now that we're gonna be absorbing that, because that's kind of what we're talking about right here. You know, St. Paul's field is great, but once they become HVL athletes, are we responsible to get them out to the field and back every day after school? Who's gonna take the kids out there? Do we now have to have a bus that gets them there? What's the legalities of that? And what's our responsibility in that? Okay.
You don't ever have to get a child to practice, like golf or anything like that.
Okay.
I'm just asking the question. I thought he was asking for an answer.
No, I'm not. Actually, I'm not looking for any answer.
Yeah, I like the answer.
I'm kind of going to echo what some of the concerns that the coaches put out there. You know, when it does come to coaches, we are going to have control over that, yeah, and over the hiring and firing of, because that's a big part of it. You know, they're going to be HVL athletes, they're going to be part of the HVL, it's going to be part of the school. That's a question that needs to be asked. We do have one AD, and he's been stretched to the brink here. Is this going to, this is something you don't have to answer tonight. I'm just saying, I'm echoing a few things that were put out here. What about the athletic trainer? You know, we've got a pretty good situation now, and she runs all over the place. If we still have Beth, is Beth still here, or do we have a different one? Okay. And I mean, she runs all over the place, you know? Is what's that gonna do to her to give her one more field a mile from school to get to if she has to be there, okay? Our enrollment is growing, so that's a good thing. Title IX we talked about, you know. So those are just a couple things. I think it's great. I mean, I really do. And you know what? If you look at schools over the last 10, 15 years throughout the state that have added soccer, there's been some hoops to jump through for every single one of them. Because of some of the concerns that the coaches have put out. Do we have enough kids to support them? Are you going to meet Title IX? Are you going to do this stuff? There's really been some consternation in these school districts as they've added these sports. But as far as I know, they've all worked out just fine, you know? So those are some things I'd like to see, some questions I'd like to see answered. Because I really would like to see whether that's going to be 2 years down the road when the district takes over the reins of having to pay for the program.
That'd be kind of a crystal ball though, one that looking at 2 years.
Well, I think they can at least keep track of what they're spending right now and come back and say, you know what, it cost us $10,000 last year to run this program.
Actually, they do have some numbers that I've seen.
Okay.
With startup, that's uniforms, balls, paint for the striping, refs, athletic fees. I think right now, and this is with everything being thrown in, it's a gross of $12,000. And there's things in there that are one-time costs that will go away, nets and different things once they're bought, they're in. I guess I understand the fiscal side of it, and I understand that. But I do see a bunch of kids in here that I think would love to go out and run and have a Cannon Falls jersey on, too. And right now, they really can't do that for our district. When does the official season start, Jay?
The fall season. Mid-August.
Okay. So that's mid-August before school comes back into session.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Practices.
But we would be getting revenue from activity fees as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Correct.
So we'd have time to see how that balances out.
Well, I think we can't answer a lot of questions until we get into it itself.
Well, they're already playing club, correct? How many years have they been playing club? 2 years. How many kids are involved? Boys, girls, or just boys? How many of those individuals played football or?
Two or three.
One?
Okay.
So there's really no impact on the football side of it right now.
But it could for younger kids.
It could.
Kids.
Yeah.
It could,
well,
you know.
Right. It's another sports offering.
But they, my point is, they've had this going for 2 years and it's never even been noticed in the community.
Right.
I mean, reality, it hasn't.
Right. I mean, my concern really when I'm looking at this is we don't meet for another month. It's end of May. School gets out a week later. And if this were to get approved, what's that going to do to the timeline of trying to get this thing up and running before the season starts this fall?
We had that conversation. That's why this discussion is happening tonight.
Right. I mean, we can discuss tonight. We wait a month, we vote, okay, then a week later school's out, people go on vacation. You're going to try and put a schedule together for teams and everything? I guess it's kind of tough. I mean, I guess I'd like to see it. If it's going to succeed, let's give them every opportunity possible to succeed, at least the first year. Otherwise, we're going to start behind the eight ball.
You have any input on that as far as scheduling?
I can get a schedule together. I can wait till the end of the year to get a schedule together. Whether the soccer routine will post it together.
You know, for some of you, you've been on top of this. You've been integral parts of that conversation. For others of us, this is kind of the first reading we have here. And if we look at the time we've taken in transportation and the time we've taken in that PE conversation, to just cross and dot this tonight doesn't feel like we've given enough time for everyone. But yet, you know, you guys are making some recommendations, I guess. So I'm kind of torn because I just, on a personal level, it looks all plus. You know, and we've got support there. There's a possibility that we at least have some discussion about cooperative, you know, which would only add numbers to us. So, you know, there's some real positive things, but if we can just wait and get some of these other things answered, I would feel personally better, but yet, I don't know if I'm in the minority on that or not.
Let me ask this question. You know, when we do business, there's deal breakers out there. And I think you've mentioned a few of the deal breakers. Are any of the questions that we have deal-breaking questions? Or are they questions that we're going to want to gather information up as we go and figure out the solution as we go? Or are they, or is anything we put out there said, the answer is no, we should never approve this?
You know, I wish I could answer that, but because the conversation is new, I haven't looked at the other side of the equation to say, yeah, this would be a deal breaker, but yet I haven't had a chance to talk to both sides yet. And I enjoy talking to both sides because you get the whole picture there. And nothing against soccer. As a matter of fact, I think it would be a plus for our district, but have we looked at the cons of it? We're looking at all the pros, which are many, but have we discussed the cons yet? So I don't know what they might be, but I would listen to people who have an opinion on it as well.
Would it be something where we could, I mean, this is an option, we don't have a meeting until May, is there something where we could collect the information and get together and just vote on it then?
I think end of May is, what I'm hearing Jake say is fine. We can work with that date, right?
Yeah.
I don't think you have to rush. I think we're okay.
Yeah,
a lot of that data is already
months,
together.
So.
Yeah.
It's not a rush.
Right. I feel like we've been working on it for 2 years,
yeah,
too. But, you know, I think I've seen what Jake has, and he's talked to other ADs. There's games that he can get. He's put a lot of work into this, so I don't think there's a ton of legwork to still do. I think taking your time, answering those questions, doing it right is what we've been doing all through the cut process and everything. It's kind of slow down, discuss things, talk. I think that's okay. You're going to have people after this meeting come and talk to you about those cons. You know, I think it's important to talk to the other head coaches and listen to what they're saying. They had a great meeting the other day. You know, there's some valid things. There's people that have been coaching here for 10 years, you know, and have good input on that. My job is to look at revenue. My job is to look at enrollment. You've told me that all along. Every decision I've ever brought to you is based on how can I bring kids into our district. That's my job. For 2 years, our enrollment has gone up because I'm driving everywhere, I'm getting these kids, I'm offering different things. You know, you tell the principals to offer curriculum people want to come here for, you want programming that entices them to come here. What I hear from when I take people on tours of our school, they're just shocked because there is no other school of 1,200 students that doesn't have a soccer program. We're unique. Is that good or is that bad? I don't know. You know,
right.
But that's what I'm bringing to you is an option to look at revenue or at least generating more kids to come to our school. If Randolph decides to do a co-op with us or something like that, that's more students, you know, just like our wrestling program and our cross-country program and, you know, those athletics that are bringing those kids to our school too, those people are coming to our community, maybe having lunch in our community. It's about bringing people here and having them, even after a game, spend money in our town, those types of things. So my job is to look at that. I don't think you have to rush that decision. I think talking about it tonight is fine. You've got a lot of people here to give you their 2 cents worth. I think we're okay with the end of May making a decision whether it's yes or no.
Maybe it's ample time to look at Randolph and see what their feelings are on it too.
Yeah, up until 2 weeks ago, I had no clue they had soccer in the community because my kids are so far removed. I mean, I knew it was around, but the amount of kids that are playing it, I was pretty stunned.
All of a sudden, too, I have a lot of kids that like to stop by my office. It's really weird that way. They've never stopped by before, but now they do.
I was going to say, I'm definitely a sports program, and my son's played soccer for a while. And it was like there wasn't anywhere to go with it because it was just at St. Paul's. And I always thought at least Community Ed should run it, but I didn't know about the cost or anything involved and just the management of the program. But it sounds like this is the first that I've really heard, but I don't know all the details. So it feels like I'm not, don't have the information to make a decision, but I think it sounds like a win-win for everybody.
The toughest thing is that 2 years. Are we setting you up in 2 years, you're going to have to make an even harder decision. And Jake and I have talked about this a lot, too. You know, that's when, where will the support be? How much, you know, if they get a soccer booster club going or whatever that is, will they have funds? You know, that gets to be a delicate balance. And you don't want to get a really successful program up and going and then say, you know, we can't, we don't have the money for that. So, and everything will be a financial decision. We aren't in a place to add anything expense-wise. We're just not in that setting. We've cut $350,000 worth of things, so it's going to be tough in 2 years to look at that, too.
But we have a chance to try it, it sounds like, without the cost to the district, so. Sounds like a good thing.
Anyone else? Good conversation. I think we're, for the most part, we're all in agreement much of the time here. It's just that, to me, there's just a little bit more I'd like to have, information I'd like to have. And again, some of you have been working on this. Congratulations on that. But I wasn't a part of it, so it's new to me. It's absolutely new to me. So, okay, ready to move forward? Thank you. Discussion, booster clubs. You know, we've had a booster club for a number of years, and the Bomber Boosters disbanded for whatever reason. And in an overlap time, we've had the football boosters. We've also got dance boosters. And I think as a board, we've had some discussion in the past about who we are relative to the booster club. And at the MSBA convention, there was some conversation from the head of the high school league. And at least when you go to these conventions, there's probably 50 seminars, and you can pick and choose over the two-day time which is germane to you, which you'd like to, you know, information you'd like to see. I go to the high school league stuff because that fits for me. But one of the topics of conversation was the booster clubs for individual schools, and the conversation, I guess Kurt can handle that, but essentially was less is better when it comes to clubs. And that was our thought process many years ago when the Bomber Boosters began. But we since have moved to the football boosters, and we have dance line. So just a little preliminary discussion. Kurt, you've looked into this.
Yeah, having gone to those little in-services at the Minnesota School Board Association, there's some things that came to mind. And one of it is, are we following Title IX? And I didn't know if we should bring it up sooner or later in the last several months because of the budget, but maybe now is a good time to talk about it, especially not we're talking about soccer, whether or not this is something we can support. I specifically addressed this to the executive director of the Minnesota State High School League, and that's Dave Steed.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying people aren't doing what's necessary, but we want to make sure as a district that all the booster clubs are following the bylaws, the statutes, the policies and procedures appropriately. And I'm not sure if we are, and that's something as a board I think we should consider. Dave Steed specifically states that state law requires all monies expended for school activities to be accepted and expended by the school district, and a full accounting of such funds must be maintained. Which basically says all booster clubs should be coming to the board and opening their books up, if you will, showing us what their budget for the following upcoming fiscal year is, and showing us how that's going to be appropriated, showing us what they made for that year and how their expenses are being expended, or how their expenses are and what they are, and if they're appropriate or not. Now there's feelings out there that say, you know, you can have a main booster club, which we had, and for some that works very well. And then there's some that have a main booster club and they have what they call splinter cells or splinter clubs, and that they go out and they raise their own funds. The problem that they're having, what they're saying right now, and Dave Steed has mentioned that he likes the idea of one booster club, and that's not why I'm here, but the reason why is that because of Title IX, in situations such as this with soccer, we can't fund soccer as a district because we have all these separate clubs out there. We don't have one main booster club anymore. And that is working against us. Now, it doesn't mean that we can't still have one main booster club and have these splinter clubs involved with it, but what are our options as a district? What's going to work best for us? There's the point where if you have one main booster club, it doesn't mean that these athletic or these individual sports aren't going to get what they're budgeting for. It just means show us a budget, let us know what you need, and whatever you raise, you know, you have your budget and you get that paid for, but whatever you raise for that the rest of the year, if you don't use that money, it goes into the general fund for the main booster club. And then that goes to appropriate whatever other clubs are out there that can't support it, such as what dance can do and what football can do, because those are the big entities out there. Those are the ones that get the monies because they are successful. They do very well. They have a high profile. These other smaller groups, they don't have that opportunity, and that's why Title IX's out there. That's why a main booster club is out there. That's somewhat been taken away because we have our own individual booster clubs. We need to sit back and look at this and see if this is what's right for our district. And what I'm thinking is that maybe we could get together with some of the people on every booster club and see what they're doing and see how we can work with this. I don't know if that's enough, if that explains where we're at right now. Gary?
I think so. I think letting them allow us to find out what monies are coming in, what monies are going up, we're ultimately responsible for that. We're the ones that should be seeing it. And if we're not, it needs to start happening.
You know, I had conversation very recently, and they, you know, we haven't been able to adequately fund some of our programs, and football is our most expensive program. And I think sometimes we send kids out there without the absolute best in safety because of money. And that's a pretty sad commentary, and unless we decide we're going to fund these programs entirely, and including their equipment, as up-to-date and as safety-conscious as we possibly can, the Booster Club is a good partner for us. And so my concerns sometimes are more toward the safety. I'd like to say, you know, you get your money, you get your budget, but certainly an expensive program, if you will, like football, deserves their share for safety purposes. It's a heavy contact sport, and we have to be careful that we want a partner, but ultimately we do have to answer to high school league and appropriations and things like that. So this certainly isn't a knock. It's more of a let's sit down and make sure that we've got all of our ducks in a row as well as you. Correct?
Correct.
Okay. Anyone else?
With that being said, would it be appropriate this time to just make a request, Jake, that we do try and set something up with some of the people on the booster clubs and start the discussion?
You know, you and Jerry have gone to lengths to have conversation about this and do some, I guess, work on that. So I think it's just appropriate that you guys continue with that.
Okay. Right, but I think the direction that we'd like to go is start with Jake, and me and Kurt would be more than happy to be supporting in that gathering of people that are running these booster clubs. And I think Jake is kind of looking for direction from Kurt and I after our meeting on what direction he would like the board to see him go. So this is the direction that we'd like to take it, as far as sitting down with Kurt, myself, and Jake, and bringing the board members of the booster clubs, or couple people off each booster club that's currently facilitated. We'd sit down with them and have this discussion, and so we're all on the same page and we know what direction we need to go. So I guess that's what I would like to see happen. I guess I'll leave it up to the rest of you. If you guys are all in favor for Jake's kind of spearheading and getting the group together, and me and Kurt would be more than happy to sit down and support.
Okay. I think that's a good idea. And again, they're partners of ours. They're assisting us when we don't have the opportunities,
right,
financial opportunities. So
couldn't do it without them.
We just need to make sure that we're covered. And again, this was our conversation. When the football boosters came to us, they said, you know, we're an apolitical group. What we want to do is fundraise. We want to help our kids, and safety was an issue, I think, Craig, when we talked about that. It was the biggest, the drive behind it. So, you know, we would certainly support that because you're assisting us at the same time. But, you know, we need to make sure what we're doing is correct according to the people that are on top of us, and that would be the high school league. So you guys are into this pretty knee-deep. I think that would be a good opportunity to meet with Jake, and, you know, booster clubs are very supportive of us, so they'd be supportive of sitting down as well. Okay?
We're good.
Yep. Keep going. Item G, discussion field house update from Dave Davison. Dave, last time we spoke, it was about do we have ourselves covered? Do we need to put somebody in that field house to watch? We have, I guess, we've got it open all the time.
Yeah, it's open all the time. Discussion there about certain things, and Beth and I came up with, or further mentioned about having like a sign there to let people know as far as hours of use, things that are acceptable in there, what isn't acceptable in there, and stuff like that. So okay, it's only been a couple of weeks, so turned out to see if anything has to be tweaked on that stuff. The thing is, house is used all the time. And I haven't had as much time these last couple of weeks to look into some things just because I've been so busy taking care of activities, set up, tear downs, different crew rates, stuff like that, with volleyball tournaments, that wrestling tournament, stuff like that. But feel that we've got pretty much what we need on as far as the signs that we've posted right now, to buy them and stuff like that, we're probably, you know, looking at $500 for signs and stuff like that. The door closed and stuff, and things that we have to beef up because it's not strong enough. But I say the place does get used and it's good to see, and as far as I can tell right now, it's not getting
questions for Dave.
So we're going forward with the cameras, or are you just still specking them out?
I mean, if that's what you want me to do, I can go ahead with it. I say I get a firm price this week on that, but during deal with about $2,000.
My recommendation on it would be, you know, instead of, you don't know where you're going to go with the police liaison yet. We've got some money set aside, some grant things that are going to be coming in on that. Dave and I are working with all of that. If he chooses to upgrade all the cameras, it might be better to do a system-wide thing. I mean, we haven't even looked at that yet. So, yeah, we definitely can fund those, but I'd like to look at the whole system.
The other thing with cameras or whatever, Jim and I met with a rep on fire security issues, as far as we have bonds with cameras, those type of things.
Mm-hmm.
And waiting for some information.
Right. That's what I'm getting, you know, doing the whole thing, doing it right.
The question I have with cameras, if we do them, if they work well enough, do we have a policy on accountability with that? You know, what is it? What is our policy of what we do when someone does damage properties of the school? Do we follow up with it? Do we?
Well, we use cameras for that.
Yep, but what is our accountability to that individual that's caused destruction, damage to the property? Do we do anything with it?
Depends on the value. If it's over $500, you call the police. I mean, there's different issues.
What if it's under 500?
It gets to be an interesting situation. Mr. Hodges has dealt with many of those.
Right.
He asked the parents to replace the garbage can that they destroyed, things like that.
Is it a policy that we do that, or is that just something that we just do?
We just do. You can ask Mr. Hodges how that works out, but they replace the item they ruined.
We don't need a policy for that, okay?
I would recommend not.
How about for non-school-aged kids?
We had a situation last year where there was an adult who did something, I think it was a weight room door, is that right? And they were served with a letter that said they weren't within a year.
Yep.
Not allowed.
Not allowed in that building.
Okay, so.
We did have a minor field house having to do with the lift and the pole vault pit or something like that, didn't we?
Yeah, a couple years ago.
What was the outcome to that? How was that dealt with? You know, we happened to have a camera on the right spot, as I recall. Was there an outcome where somebody had to pay back for that vandalism, or?
That one predates me. So.
Well, as much as we need another policy, and I'm not for that, I do see that, what are the repercussions if someone is in there? We've been really blessed because people think, the community thinks the same of the field house as we all do. Otherwise, we'd have continued instances of vandalism and problems, but we haven't had any. And that thing is open till what time in the evening?
Basically, the hours, Monday through Friday, it's 6 a.m. to 8:05 when school starts, then from 8:05 to 2:55, basically you have to report to the office if you want to go into the field house. Then from 2:55 to 10:30 every night, Monday through Friday, and on the weekend, 6 in the morning to 6 at night. With first for that, all school activities, games, practice, events, and other outside group events take precedence over that. And basically, the field house is open.
It's open. I think, you know, for whatever, I think that's a small price to pay to protect, because $2,000 or $3,000 in vandalism doesn't go very far. And even though we haven't seen it, this would be more of a preemptive thing. So. On a personal level, I think it's a good idea, but we'll just continue on, I guess. And we have other things to look into, and the liaison is part of that. So, okay. Anyone else? Okay. Transportation, item H, another discussion item. Rob and I have been at least in conversation. I think we opened it up to the board probably in October or November of last year. And, you know, initially it was a prompt from me because I felt like our fleet is aged and is not getting any newer, and where are we going to come up with that? Is there a need to sell our school bus fleet and have somebody else take over that? On one side of the coin, it's like people said, you know, if you do that, you lose all control. And ultimately, the people that are making decisions for our buses, is the company, not ourselves. And we found that not to be true in fairly constant conversation. And it's worked its way to this point where we're, Rob and I in judgment are talking about maybe not selling off our fleet and having somebody else do it. But Rob, you had you got some history there for us, which I think is good.
I do. Like I said, Bob and I have been working on this for quite a while. And at times we get into it so far that we forget that maybe you guys aren't up to speed on where we're at with everything. So this was kind of that. We need to bring you guys up to speed, what we've been doing and why we've been doing it. You know, as Bob said, we've been fight with the new buses, not being able to afford one. We've been fighting with decisions on, do we do nothing and keep it the way it is, which not that viable of an option. We're limping through this year, but we've had our difficulties all the way to the point of selling off everything from the buses, maybe renting the building out to whoever buys our buses, capitalizing on the equipment that we're gonna get the cash for. But when it's gone, we're done. We own buildings, we own no buses, nothing. And this took a couple months. I mean, we looked at a few companies, talked to quite a few districts about this. The sound of the buses really, it sounds like even those that did it didn't really, if they could do it again, they might not. And then an opportunity presented itself where we might do a hybrid, a combination, where we can keep our assets. We wouldn't be getting any revenue from them for 1 or 2 years, which we're talking $300,000 to $400,000 for selling our buses. But that would go away pretty quick. So we're looking at hiring out the management of the drivers, part of that, and Beth, you can speak better of this than I can, which is the Obamacare that's coming down, that is going to be a concern for the district in the near future. But what we're looking at is, this kind of gives us that gray area where we can walk this path for 2 years, because we're right now, we're looking at contracting up for 2 years the services. We still have to keep, as a board, the thoughts of buying new buses, how and when we're going to do that. But it would help with the health care that's coming down and saving costs there. But with this option, it lets us go, if we want to pull everything back into the district, including the management of the drivers, if maybe this health care isn't as big a deal as we are fearing, or it changes, it might be a viable option to pull it back in, where if we sold all of our assets, we wouldn't have that option. If in 2 years we feel that maybe the right option is to still sell off our assets, we still have that option. And maybe used buses will be worth more than, I don't know. But we've been looking at everything from doing nothing to getting rid of everything and trying to find a place that we think would be best to serve the district, not only today, but in the near future and the long term. It does not relieve that responsibility to buy new buses. Talking with Beth, she thinks we can probably go another year. We got a zero write-up again this last year on our buses, which that's 2 years in a row, I believe, right, Beth?
There were some small ones the year before.
Small ones, okay. So we got nothing this year.
Well, I can say they were easy. They probably weren't
easy, but. No comment in the back. That must be okay.
Yeah, Andy's not saying anything.
No, so we must be fairly accurate. So that's really where we're at right now, is looking at a 2 year contract of keeping our assets, moving the management of the drivers out. And there's some great, there's some things that we still have to discuss, the routing and everything. It wouldn't be just throw it over the fence. The routing, we would still have our hands in a little bit to help out where need be. But for the most part, the day in and day out operations wouldn't rest with the district anymore. And that's where we're really hiring that third party company to come in and take care of all those things. So if you may have heard, and again, might not have made to the board meetings, where we've had countless hours with Lori, and I know Jake was down there at one point, and Beth was down there helping with the management of the transportation of the kids every day. That part wouldn't need to come back to our table anymore. I don't know if you guys remember last fall, we had the start of the school year is kind of disruptive. You guys remember that? Yeah. Well, that's really what prompted a lot of this.
What we had is looking as far as lease to own, that I'm going to make an assumption that that's still something that's being looked at for new buses if we so decide to keep our fleet.
Matter of fact, we looked at some numbers, and I'm glad you brought that, because it's something I thought we'd already talked about, but I don't think we did. A lease to own, where we could possibly basically buy 3 buses for the price of one. You pay for it over a number of years, but it used to be the school districts always paid cash up front. You could buy a bus. With the interest rates the way they are, leasing these buses, and we'll own them at the end, but we can replace the fleet a little bit quicker if we need to in the beginning, because we've been holding off. So maybe we do 3 buses for about the price of one. We'll pay over for the next few years, but it's easier to budget, and it helps to replace what we need to replace sooner.
Other questions? So again, we very early in our conversation, we talked to Benjamin Buss from Northfield, I think, and just had conversation about the viability of them owning everything. And then we had conversation with Tom Burr. Some may recognize his name. He's he's the fleet manager supervisor, something up in that Elk River area, I believe.
Yes.
And it was Tom's recommendation that we look to a third party, and that would be Chuck Corliss, who his main thing is looking at efficiency in the areas of school district, and his expertise is most notably in transportation. And he says we're doing a good job, that we run this thing on the, as we do so much of our stuff, bare bones. But the Obamacare thing, there's a potential for this to cost us several hundred thousand dollars. We don't know, but we can't move, stick our head in the sand and say, well, if it comes to us, then we're going to have to deal with it. If it happens, we're really behind the eight ball. And I think that 2 years that we talked about is a good enough time to see if that actually is going to happen in its present form. Plus, for me, with less administration, we're asking them to take the lead as far as being the overall supervisor of transportation. It started with Todd, and it's melded into Beth and into Lori. So for me, it's if we're continuing to be efficient and we intend to operate our administrative offices as threadbare as we do, we have to look at other alternatives here. And hiring out or expanding, I guess, the job description for Sandstrom, who's doing our mechanical work right now, seems like our best alternative. And it's a 2-year commitment. We don't lose our buses. We continue to do that. We're still going to have to find a way to pay for new ones. But I think this is fitting for us, and especially for that Obamacare and that admin reason. We did have a meeting with the transportation group this morning, and we haven't necessarily, we haven't had any continuing meetings with them about this, because there's no point in bringing them into the equation until we know that that's what we're going to do. Otherwise, we're just asking for conversation without being able to tell them anything. So this morning, that was our conversation, and this is a discussion item, but can become an action item. And I think we should seriously consider that. It would be my recommendation that we move in this direction of subcontracting our bus drivers out to Mr. Sandstrom. And I think it's a good fit. Like Tom Burr, it's a local guy with local ties, and I feel very comfortable in our conversation. There is stuff to work out still.
There is stuff. We also have the timeline to think about, because again, we wait another month. We're into the summer. He's got to get everything ready for the fall season to start up.
Wasn't there also a $10,000 savings with this plan at one point?
We still don't have full, is this correct, Andy? The actual insurance items back. So we don't know what that savings will be. But obviously you're saving on para. There'll be times where some things can be driven by volunteers. So there's built-in savings that way, but a concrete number cannot be said. I would still stay pretty strong with that number, but there's no way to say for sure until those insurance numbers come back. And you haven't had an update on any of that, have you, Andy? Not yet?
Some, but not.
Right.
Well, tell you what, I'll make a motion that we contract out our transportation services for just to start the conversation.
Based on our last, you're going to make a recommendation that we turn this into an action item, I think.
Oh, that's what I got to do first.
I okay. think, based on my getting beaten down last week.
Motion that we
week.
Turn this into an action item.
Motion by Kurt for this to be an action item.
I'll second his motion.
Seconded by Pat. This is what procedure means in our life.
You're doing so good.
Now I learn. I got.
What's this going to cost a year?
Our preliminary numbers were a savings of 10 grand. Is that what you're asking? I don't know if it's, you know, hopefully it'll be more. Even if it's a break-even point, we have to look at that Obama thing. And we also have to look at our admin. How much time are they taking here that should be for things that occur inside our walls here? I think that we're still going to be able to get our kids here in a reasonable, in just a safe, conscious fashion with Andy, as we do with us, and maybe even more so because he can give it that TLC that maybe we don't have right now.
it guarantees us that we don't have to do the insurance piece of it.
That's my next question. What if that doesn't, whatever, what if this gets approved and for whatever reason it doesn't fly on the other end? Then what happens?
Well, there's still savings just on para alone and the volunteer drivers. That alone is substantial. And I don't know, this year we've only had three times where someone's wanted to volunteer a trip, where we've had a basketball coach that's wanted to take the kids to an overnight, what's the right word, game, tournament of sorts. That can get really expensive. You know, if the coach can drive and it saves a hotel room for a driver, you know, there's substantial savings there. So can you put a number to all that? I don't know how many times that's going to happen. It won't cost us anything, but it will save. I don't know what to tell you. I'll have numbers next year to tell you what the savings were.
You'll have to go through a year.
Right. I would have to, because you got to have a comparison of point A and point B.
I guess at this point, for me, the biggest question in my mind would be for the insurance, just making sure that's square on that, I guess. Yep. Or save money.
Yeah, again, even if we're breaking even, it does free up our admins for other things.
If we break even, they're not tied up, they're actually making money.
Well, it gives me more time to write grants and do those things that you guys want me doing.
And just like our two-year conversation about soccer, we'll look at this in 2 years. If it didn't seem to work out for us, or it doesn't work out for Andy, then we're back to where we are now.
I think it's a good compromise. I don't like the idea of selling the buses, because then you can't go back if it doesn't work out, or if you kind of lose control of your costs too, because then the outside company can charge you anything, and you can't take it back and take it over again if you want to. This way we do have a chance to try it out and see how it works and still have control, and we have a 2-year period to see how things go. And I'm also in favor of leasing buses to purchase as well.
So we have a motion by Kurt, seconded by Pat, to make this an action item. We've had discussion. All in favor of that, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. So the next motion would be to approve a 2-year agreement with
SafeLink.
And again, this is actually an expansion of duties, because we currently have his staff down there for our mechanics, so we're actually opening this up for more duties for SafeLink. So I would look for a motion to approve that SafeLink contract, and we would then allow our staff to work out the details, any of them, which would occur over the next month or so. Rob and I have had a couple of those things that we've discussed. I think minor, that we continue on. So
I'll make a motion.
I'll second.
So there's a motion by Kurt, seconded by Jerry, to approve a 2-year agreement, subject to the terms and conditions that the superintendent and Lori will deal with. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Reports. This isn't our report week, so we won't do that, but I'm dying to hear what's new in Ryan's life.
All right, I'll keep this short, but just this past Saturday, the speech team finished up their season at state in Blaine. 7 made it to finals, and that's including, I'll say names just to give recognition, but Sydney Earhart was the state champion. Rebecca Gasmi got second. Kaylee Stiles was third, Alex Trainer fourth, Hannah Brumman sixth, Josh Siebenaller seventh, Matt Lockett eighth. And overall, they were fourth in the state out of a total of 192 Class A teams. Yesterday, we had the band, the music department had something they do every year called Slice of Jazz, and the jazz band and the jazz choir performed at that. The Cannon Falls Middle School and High School Art Show will be on Saturday, April 27th from noon to 5, and then also on Sunday, April 28th from 11 to 3. And then student council applications, if anybody in our school in grades 8 through 11 would like to apply for student council, those applications are in the office and are due May 3rd. This Thursday is the last day to purchase prom tickets. Prom is May 4th, and Grand March starts at 4:30 in the auditorium. And this Wednesday is a PLC day, so classes start at 8:30.
Where's the art show?
It's going to be right in the
atrium.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Ryan. Our regular board meeting upcoming is May 20th, and among the items you can see down here, but we would add soccer to that equation for sure. And then I'm not sure about that insurance quotes. I'm thinking that that's maybe a little preliminary. Okay, so we would strike that, and we could add soccer into that at that point in time. Pat, the Ed Foundation works very hard as well on our school. I just wanted you to make a brief comment.
Yeah, Saturday night we had the annual fundraiser, and they raised just a little north of $40,000. Yeah, so it was a great one. Just another great night, I can tell you that it's been a real treat the last 7-8 years working with that group. They're a lot of fun, but boy, they get down to business, and they really, really put together a heck of a fundraiser down there. So kudos to them and to the community for showing out. It was another great crowd, and everybody donated, and it was fantastic. So
thank you.
How the pie taste?
The pie, well, here you can have a little if you like. I said, two showers and I can still smell it on me, but we'll thank the superintendent.
Really should have thought that through a little more, should have.
Okay, we're up to the public forum segment, and not knowing what kind of response we're going to get here, I would like to reiterate that we certainly don't want to squelch opinions when it comes to school, but we'd also like a limited number if your topic is the same. And, if there's a student rep that would like to speak, that's well and good. If there's anything other than our sports issue or issues, that's okay as well. So anybody wish to speak at this time?
Please just state your name before you speak.
I'm Adam Rieger. I'm the soccer coach for the boys.
I'm Mel, Dr. I'm a soccer mom.
We just have a couple key points that we'd like to point out here and stuff like that. We don't want to take up too much more of your time. I guess the soccer program is the best kept secret in Cannon Falls for the last 2 years, but I'm sorry you guys were never informed about that.
You guys must come see us at church or the grocery store, because everybody else that sees us wearing soccer clothing, they stop us regularly. We get involved in the soccer team. When we were getting ready for our game, so everybody tried to talk to us for quite a while, actually, asking us about our program. There's not a whole lot you can tell them when you're not through the trip, obviously. We do have the numbers, so that's the 2 cupcakes. I did a year 1 plan and a year 2 plan. Year 2, we're talking about uniforms, would be the same 7th and 12th grade. So the kids can wear them all the time. The only ones that's going to hurt us, or the ones that are going to have to pay more, are the ones that have to pay more chances, because the kids will only wear the uniform for a year. It is not our intent to take kids from the program. Sorry, but soccer kids, and you guys all know this, are different than football players. I Peter Hoffman as my example all the time. Peter Hoffman would not be a very good football player. Peter Hoffman is a heck of a soccer player. Soccer is one sport that it doesn't matter how heavy you are, how tall you are, you can play it at any size, any shape. Soccer is just an overall good thing. Soccer, we think there's longevity. There's over 300 kids in the summer soccer program up at St. Paul. Quoted from BleacherReport.com, while youth baseball's numbers continue to decline, youth soccer's numbers continue to rise. Only basketball has more youth players than soccer. Soccer participation in high school has more than doubled.
Kind of a nice surprise or side note what you said about the rec program. There's about 300 kids involved in that. Fifth through eighth grade, they all play together on the same team. We usually have enough to field four teams. Half of those are girls. So it could be a really good thing for girls also here at the school. So that's just something to know.
Last year, our kids did play two home games down at Southridge Park. If we got through the school, we've already been told we're not going down there. We won't be playing down there. We won't be practicing down there. We have St. Paul, so that's where our kids
live. Yeah, Bob, I was at that meeting also about that, so that's kind of icing on the cake. We did have two games down there last year. It was a lot of fun and stuff, but that's not a big deal. We've got fields that we can play on, practice on. It won't interfere with the rec program at all because that ends on the first week of August, and our program will start in August.
And actually, Adam is on the board at St. Paul. And at their last board meeting, they agreed that we could make that activity. So St. Paul is the most important one.
What if we are planning to do and spend our time and money and resources there instead of here? We'd like to be part of actually the solution. Football can be played on a soccer field and vice versa. We'd like to be part of the solution here of getting more fields for everyone to play football.
It was said before, for a lot of the very few schools that don't have soccer in our our boys have played, we've played FISM, we've played we've played Plainview, and our boys have done very well against them. And you have to understand for how our boys don't get to play year round. Our boys play in the summer.
In 2011, we played Red Wing, St. Croix, Byron, Pine Island, Plainview. In 2012, we played Cassin, St. Croix, Byron, Pine Island, Stewartville, and Winnemucca. The Pine Island and Stewartville games were home here at Dunbar.
And we can only officially determine them because we're not in but as far as numbers, we did have to pay for refs last year. We pretty much know what's happening because we had to pay for all of it. We actually had to make our own plays for the corners. But we paid for us. We had to buy our own paint.
Some of those costs actually could be lower. We estimated on the higher side, like for bowls and stuff, but the more we're poking around with other schools and use equipment, we could probably cut that cost for like stuff like that in half at least, if not more.
And if you look at the numbers, we're cutting $350 for a kid to play. Some of us were willing to pay $380 just for our kids to play soccer this summer and not before the season came up. Our kids just want to play. And the parents here, yeah, there's a lot for our older kids, but there are a lot of kids as far as of parents of younger kids whose kids would grow into.
Thank you. Yeah, who's your spokesman, male or female or both?
Maybe in half.
Okay.
Okay, I'll go through. I'm Amy Rutter. I'm a junior here at St. Paul's. And, well, when I was younger, I went to the St. Paul's soccer programs, and I've always enjoyed that. And I remember asking my mom a few years back before I came to high school if there was soccer in high school. And I remember her telling me no, so then I being active, I was playing tennis or volleyball. And I know for me personally and a few other girls that they've done maybe a mixture of those sports and they haven't really worked out too good for them because that's just not the type of sport is not right for them. And I think soccer would open up for them, like possibility for a few girls, if, like, as I mentioned before, if they aren't seeing the guys who are football players or cross-country runners and the same thing for the girls, they can go out and have the opportunity of a new sport to play. And when you guys brought up Randolph before, like, was the time of year for the numbers? I've talked to a few Randolph kids through the track, and they said they were interested in possibly doing that, but I don't know how much is that feasible with Randolph. But Kristen and a few of the girls might have taken it upon ourselves to go around and ask a few girls who aren't in sports, or I don't know, would want to double up on sports, and we've got quite a few numbers for starting off.
Thank you.
I'm Zach Doctor, and I've been playing on this club for about 2 years now. And when I'm also high coach. I coach at Little Summer League now since it's more soccer stuff for me. And some of the things we do, with numbers, we should be doing it for these 2 years if we get this 2 year thing going. Because we do this little clinic, the soccer clinic, in March. And these little kids, they come up, they'll come around, they'll run around, hit that ball. We have some of them come up and go, we want to be just like you. Those kids really look up to us. So with numbers, I think we have good numbers going up here through the years. And I don't know. Yesterday I was asked a few questions about this, and why I like soccer is just I've been playing it my entire life pretty much. And it's like, I don't know. It's pretty healthy. Another question is like, why shouldn't we have soccer? I cannot list anything. I think it's kind of a win-win situation for our school, because it'll get those more kids involved in, I don't know.
One other thing is, if you look at the numbers, if we pay our $125 athletic fee, and the school pays refs and transportation, and we figure the refs at $100 a rep, which we actually pay the $175 last year, the school will actually come out $400 and some dollars. That's from us paying our athletic fee. So, it's just one big thing.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak about any topic? Dave?
David Barr, Cannon Falls Youth Athletic Association. And I think I can speak for most parents here that nobody's trying to deny kids being able to play their sports and be able to do what they want to do. But Bob, as you mentioned, we're at a critical period in our sports programs. And you had mentioned that we're looking at two sides, the soccer and the non-soccer side. I think you forgot one that's really important, one that youth kids, and we have about 600 student athletes that play from third to sixth grade that rely on the assets of the school. And by having soccer and soccer fields, and I understand there's 2 years that we could be okay, but what happens in those 2 years? That we have to look at what happens to these youth programs if these fields get used up. Beth, you had mentioned that one of your big concerns is getting enrollment up, and I think we're a big contributor to keeping that enrollment up, having student athletes from third to sixth grade. I think it might use up, and keep this in mind when you're making your decision, that the assets are being used up in the school, not only the field house, but the fields in back, the fields behind the elementary. That's one big thing. And as just as a parent, not as a representative of the Youth Athletic Association, I think if we're talking about budget cuts at all, if we cut one teacher already today, I don't think we should be looking at possibly taking on any more costs in the future. Would you like me to talk about the, that's all I have to say about the soccer, because I'm, to be honest with you, that's kind of my job with Youth Athletics, is to get as many kids to play wherever they want to play as well. But about the booster clubs, do you want me to talk about that now, or should we wait for...
You know, let's wait. I think essentially what's gonna occur is representatives from all the booster clubs, or whichever booster clubs we have, can sit down and speak. And I think after that conversation is finished, you know, if it becomes an agenda item, it would certainly be something we would look for input on. But I think for now, let's... we'll forego it, because we're not making like decisions on boosters, just trying to get it all on the same page. Anyone else wish to speak?
My name is Matt Bimmon, and St. Paul has done a fantastic job for the past 3 years. My kids, my son in particular, is very great. I have 2, 4, and 9-year-old all boys. I've played soccer my entire life. When we moved here years ago, I was born. My son played with his friends. I'm currently picking my son 3 days a week from Northfield. I paid $300 for traveling at this point. He goes on in here in Canada Falls. I can assure you that the theater program in St. Paul's, as well as my kids and their friends, and my support, my coach and my camp, they're going to keep this going. This is fine as well. So I think it's very well.
Thank you. Okay, I think we'll close that public forum. And having nothing else on the agenda, I would look for a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Brenda!
I'll second.
Motion by Brenda. She took your thunder, Pat. Seconded by Pat. Any other discussion? All in favor of adjournment, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That is carried.